the data aspect of it, or collecting data around equity, which then translates to race and identity, mm-hmm. becomes can potentially be awkward and uncomfortable for people, yeah. and so they're like, "How do you do? How do you collect data? Yeah. How do you do that?
And how do you use
yeah,
it?
How do you yeah. use? Yes." Right.
We ask these questions of visitors, and we have more experience doing that. We've asked them in HR of staff for a long time because of legal
yes.
obligations, but to ask them on a survey as well. Every single time you have to be able to think about why are we collecting this data and how is it going to be used, and have people buy in that it's going to be used to make the museum better.
Mm-hmm. And I would even say the overarching topic and discussion is so vulnerable, mm-hmm. and spending that time thinking about how we create those questions in service of what
yeah.
to do and inform this, and that is going to be handled with care.
Yeah.
Knowing that there's this pacing of data collection, and we had to take quite a bit of time of introducing kind of this overarching, so much work in the organization yeah. that has been underway for years, decades. All of a sudden it became very real, particularly for our staff, because it was, now it's about me, mm-hmm. and it's not about the work that I'm doing in service of something else. And what's happening here, mm-hmm. and how do I fit mm-hmm. in within this work, mm-hmm. and how do I bring my full self when I'm not feeling safe, mm-hmm. and I don't feel like the systems are here for me? Mm-hmm. What do I do with that? How do I bring that forward? And that's really the foundation and the cycle that we've been working through to address a whole host of different things, and data being foundational to this.
Yeah. I think a key piece of that has also been, for many of the pieces of data, it's transparency, not just in the collection, but in the use of mm-hmm. it.
Yeah.
And so part of the reason that, it, for instance, with our staff survey, it took a long time to get findings out to the whole of the staff, was because we didn't want just project leaders making sense of it. We wanted the group of people, which is about 50 people who were in project teams in some way, to make sense of it. That if I sat down and just interpreted the data on my own, it remains my interpretation. But if we have a museum-wide group who do some interpretation, that provides, I think, some greater trustworthiness and also just better interpretation. Other people see different things than I do. And I think that we want to share out data, and we want to share it out as broadly as possible. But if we share raw data, that's less useful. If we share some data along with, here are the steps that we're taking, that becomes useful. And I think the HR data also, the greater openness in sharing out that data, allowed for people to say, I not only can literally see myself in the data as a manager and a white woman, and I have this tenure, I can see myself, I can find myself in the data, but I also can look and see, and I can hear from HR, how are you making sense of it? But I can also hear how my peers in the museum are making sense of it.
And I think that translates to, how do I see myself in the work? Mm-hmm. Because participating, I mean, that I think in some ways that's been the hardest thing for staff. It's like, okay, we have placed equity and inclusion as something, as a pillar of this organization, and as a value, and it is embedded in everything that we do. We think about it. It's part of our performance review process. It's part of our hiring process. It's something that is core to the museum values. And there are a lot of people we know that haven't been able to find their way into it. But if you feel, just even participating in the survey, I think is a way to not only think about how you relate to certain questions and how you respond to the questions, but it is you are then part of the work. Because when we report out, we had this many people say this, or we had this many people say that, and we are analyzing that data, and in discussions, even in small group discussions, or even when we're presenting to the full staff, people can see, I'm part of that. Mm-hmm. I'm part of something larger. Mm-hmm. So I think it's been a really useful tool. And it's been really useful to do it in consecutive years. I also think it's an entry point for people. Mm-hmm. Participate in that. Maybe you'll participate in something else. Maybe you'll come to a discussion about a book or a video or something, because it is a way to begin even an internal dialogue or an external dialogue. Mm-hmm.
The one thing that I found incredibly valuable in the survey was the reality within the data. And so there was a lot of anecdotal, let's try this. What about this? The data, you know, from a human resources demographic reporting, like check the box kind of element, that's one element. But a piece to that puzzle, there's so many others. So what's the rest of the story? What do we do with that? And taking that information and redesigning, reevaluating, totally scrapping something and starting new and rebuilding creates a much more authentic or so we were moving away from a disingenuous environment for staff that was more of a check the box to this is a place that people exist and we want to learn from and create together. For me, don't be afraid of what the data will tell you. Know that it's part of the journey. And there will be moments where you'll make steps forward and then you'll make steps back. And what matters, I think, oftentimes the most is how we respond to the moments that we take steps back and then progress forward. That there is no end to this journey, unfortunately. We don't expect that to be in our lifetime, which is really, really the reality of this.
So I am a leader of color. And I'm a leader of color at an institution that has this core value of equity and commitment to it. But it is a primarily white organization. And so that for me, there is a level of what I would say constant disruption, that I feel like I have to do that. And it's healthy. And it may be uncomfortable for me or other people at times, but it's really, it's essential. Mm-hmm. And it's essential to change. And I'm committed to it. And so if I were to go to another museum, and it might be different, and the demographics and, you know, the makeup of the composition of the staff could be different, I would still be committed to a certain level of disruption, because change doesn't happen without it.
Recognizing I'm a white woman in a role that has power and authority, and to not only that, within the construct of human resources that create systems, mm-hmm. that whether intentionally or unintentionally could be and is minimizing individuals, and taking the time to really process and what that risk is that's creating harm for individuals, and then saying, how do we change that?
We got results that told us that white people, they should not be surprising, that white people feel more comfortable on average at SMM mm-hmm. than staff of color. And if we had asked that question and not been willing to say, this is what we found, and we're going to try and fix that, and not in a disingenuous, hand wavy, like, we'll fix that, that's no big deal. Instead to say, that's a big deal, and we should fix that. And let's also acknowledge the range across both white staff that might include people who feel uncomfortable because of some other aspect of their identity or because of some other reason that we don't even know about. People are not averages. And so our staff of color, there's also a range there. But we couldn't ask that question if we didn't know we were going to follow up, no matter what we found out.
Right.
And so I would really want people who are considering using data like a staff survey to think about their institution's willingness to act. Mm-hmm.